We're going to be studying the book of Jude. There's only one chapter, so we're going to get through the entire one this evening. I thought it very interesting when I started to do this study that you're going to hear things and read things. If you never really read the book of Jude, as we go through this, you're going to hear and read a lot of things that were spoken by Paul, spoken by Peter. So some of this is not going to be new, but I like the perspective that Jude wrote this. And as we go along, you'll see why. Again, I have to have the Bible Project for the book of Jude. So anybody that cannot hear this, everyone should be able to hear it. So we'll just begin it. If you cannot hear it, please say something.
The letter of Jude, or more accurately, Judah, according to the pronunciation of his name, both in Greek and in Hebrew. Judah was one of Jesus' four brothers, who are named in the gospel accounts. None of the brothers followed Jesus as the Messiah before his death, but afterwards they saw him alive from the dead and then became his disciples. All these brothers of Jesus became leaders eventually in the first Jewish Christian communities, and Judah was known as a traveling teacher and missionary. And this gives us the background to understand the purpose of his letter. We don't know what specific church community. His writing style assumes a deep knowledge of the Hebrew Old Testament scriptures, as well as other popular Jewish literature. Let us understand the letter's design. It begins with an opening charge, followed by a long warning and accusation against corrupt teachers who had to about what this church is supposed to do. Judah begins by charging this church to contend for the true Christian faith. He says his plan was to write a longer work that explored our shared salvation through the Messiah. But that project, he says, got delayed when he heard the urgent, very short letter. Judah doesn't begin with how they're supposed to contend for the faith. Rather, he first goes into why. It's because of the corrupt teachers who have infiltrated this church. And it's not their teaching that he targets, but their way of life. Their moral compound, they've distorted God's grace as a license to sin. They think that they're forgiven and they have God's spirit, so now they can do whatever they want, especially when it comes to money and sex. And so Judah says they betray Jesus by rejecting his authority and his teachings. And Judah wants this church to know that the appearance of these teachers is no surprise. He transitions into a longer warning to stay away from them. He first offers two sets of three Old Testament examples. The first trio is about rebellious people who in the past received divine justice. So the Israelites who rebelled against God in the wilderness, they got what they wanted and they died out in the middle of nowhere. Then he brings up a story about angels who are imprisoned for rebellion until they face God's justice. He's referring to the interpretation of the story in Genesis 6 offered in the popular Jewish work called First Enoch, where the sons of God are interpreted to refer to angels who rebelled against God, then had sex with women and were judged accordingly. Judah links this story to his third example about the ruin of Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis, where violent men tried to have sex with angels. Both these stories are about rebellion against God's order that led to sexual immorality, and that's precisely what the corrupt teachers are guilty of. After this, Judah brings up a bonus example from a popular Jewish text called the Testament of Moses. Like Enoch, it was not part of the Old Testament scriptures, and it was a creative retelling of Moses' final days and words based on Deuteronomy. In the section that Judah quotes from, Moses has died, and there's a good angel, Michael, who is refuting the devil's accusations against Moses, but he decides to leave final judgment for God alone. Now, these stories might seem kind of odd to you, but for Jewish people who were raised on this literature, Judah's warnings make good sense. The behavior of these corrupt teachers has ancient roots: rebellion against God's authority, sexual immorality, rejecting God's messengers. And this connects to the second trio of examples. They're all about rebels who went on to corrupt other people. So Cain, he murdered his brother, but then he went on to build a city where violence reigned. Balaam, the sorcerer, he couldn't curse Israel, and so he lured them into idolatry and sexual corruption. And then Korah, the Levite, he led a rebellion against Moses that ended in disaster for others. Judah concludes the second trio with a barrage of Old Testament images to describe the teachers. They're like the selfish shepherds of Ezekiel, or like the clouds with no rain from Proverbs, or like the chaotic waves from Isaiah. Their self-absorption betrays their claim to follow Jesus. They create chaos wherever they go. Judah concludes his warning by quoting from two other warnings, one ancient and one recent. The first comes, again, from the popular book of 1 Enoch, which claimed to contain the visions of the ancient figure Enoch from the book of Genesis. Now, what's fascinating is Judah quotes from the opening chapter of Enoch, which is itself quoting about half a dozen Old Testament texts about the final day of the Lord's justice on human evil. Judah then matches Enoch's ancient warning with a more recent one from the apostles. Peter, John, Paul, they all predicted that corrupt teachers would arise and distort the good news about Jesus. And they themselves were echoing Jesus' early warning about the same thing. And so this church should need no more convincing. These teachers have to be dealt with. So Judah then moves into his closing charge. He picks up his opening line about contending for the faith, and he unpacks how to do so with a cool set of metaphors. He describes the community of Jesus as God's new temple, and so they are to build their lives on the foundation of the most holy faith, which refers to the core message of good news about Jesus' life, death, and resurrection for our sins. On that foundation, the church is to build itself through a dedication to prayer, by devoting itself to the love of God through obedience. And the integrity of this building will be maintained by staying alert for the return of Jesus to bring his justice and his mercy. And in doing this, they will help each other stay faithful to Jesus. Judah then concludes by praising the God who will protect his people and keep them from falling too far from his grace. The short letter of Judah is powerful and puzzling for many modern readers who ask why he quotes from texts that aren't today considered part of the Hebrew Bible, like 1 Enoch or the Testament of Moses. It's important to remember that Jewish culture in this time was immersed in religious texts. Jesus, his family, all the early Jewish Christians grew up reading the Hebrew Bible along with many later books that were based on and inspired by the scriptures. And we know there were ancient debates about whether or not some of these later books should be viewed as scripture, but regardless, they're still important. A book doesn't have to be in the Bible to speak an important message to God's people. And so we have many Jewish texts from this period. They're known today as the collections of the Apocrypha, also called the Deuterocanon, along with the Pseudepigrapha. These were all preserved and read in Jewish and Christian communities. They were treated with great respect. It doesn't mean they were originally designed as part of the Hebrew Bible, but they are part of the biblical tradition. And so Judah, knowing his readers that they would value words from 1 Enoch, he used them to communicate his message, which is this: God's grace through Jesus demands a whole life response, not just intellectual assent. Notice that Judah doesn't criticize or focus on the teacher's theology, but their immoral way of life, which denies Jesus. And so Judah is here applying what Jesus first told his disciples: if you really love me, then you will obey my teachings. For Christians, how you live is the most reliable indicator of what you actually believe. And that's what the letter of Jude is all about.
So those of you that watched that, I hope you got out of it. One of the things that stuck out to me was reading from the book of Enoch and the book of Moses. And like he was saying, that even though they're not part of the Hebrew Bible, they were letters and they were writings that the Hebrews also incorporated into their religious daily beliefs. And the one thing that really stood out was it said that even though it's not in the Bible, it doesn't mean that it's not necessary, or that, in essence, it doesn't have to be in there to still be important. And it is. There have been many men, even today, who have written books and have written good things that gives you great information. Now, yes, they do reference scripture, but I've read some things from some people, and it's very encouraging. Their perspective brings a new light into things. So just because, and this is what Judah, really, he was actually a brother of Jesus, and he having to deal with the new Messianic Jews, they still would remember, and they were still more likely to receive from him the things that were written in some of those writings that they were used to hearing. And still being incorporated into this new life of worshiping and knowing that Jesus Christ is the way. So I think that's one of the things I really took when I started to study this one, is that, okay, there's definitely other writings that were referenced that it's not in our canons of the Bible, but there's a lot of writings that were out there. Men, there's a lot of men that wrote. Josephus, there's quite a few who wrote historic books, and some had great knowledge, and the information was very, very useful, and I think it is still today. So let's do with the introduction. In several passages throughout the New Testament, we find serious warnings about impending apostasy. Apostasy is an act of refusing to continue to follow, obey, or recognize a religious faith. Jesus warned that false prophets would arise, the love of many would grow cold, and only those who endure to the end would be saved. We find this in Matthew 24, verses 11 through 13. I did not put these scriptures in here, so it's for you to use these scriptures, go back and research them. Paul foretold of many disciples being drawn away. It's written in Acts 20, verses 29 and 30. Peter warned about the rise of false teachers and how many would follow their destructive ways. We just finished up in Peter. This is 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. By the time the epistles of John and Jude were written, the danger was no longer pending. It was very much in existence. Antichrists were present and false prophets were in the world. Find this in 1 John 2:18, chapter 4, verse 1, and then 2 John 1, verse 7. Jude was forced to change his original purpose to deal with the crisis. Find this in Jude 1. We'll see this in 3 through 4. The danger of apostasy was already present in the first century AD. We should not be surprised that the danger exists in the 21st century. We would do well to pay close heed to those epistles written to tell us how to deal with apostasy. And that makes the Epistle of Jude especially relevant. One of the things I definitely am a believer in is we have Antichrist today. Now, everyone's looking for the one Antichrist that's going to be the leader, but there are many Antichrists that are out here today. There were Antichrists that were present and false prophets in the first century. They're here today. There will be one who will raise up to be the leader of the Antichrist. But we got, when you think about Antichrist, that's just meaning that you're against Christ. You're either for him or you're against him. So we've got many out here today who are spreading so much evil, apostasy. Negativity, hatred towards Christians, towards God's people, towards God. And it's a lie. The danger does exist now in the 21st century. The author, Jude, has stated in his salutation that he does not identify himself as an apostle and appears to distinguish himself from the apostles, suggests he was not the apostle. So Jude was not an apostle. Let's keep going. He's not the apostle Jude. His self-identification as the brother of James leads many to believe the author to be Judah, brother of James, and also the Lord Jesus. It's found in Matthew 13:55. Like James, Jude chose not to insinuate his physical relationship to Jesus, but his spiritual one, a bond servant of Jesus Christ. Just like James, they did not follow Jesus while he was walking the earth, but once he was crucified, buried, and resurrected, being his brothers, they saw him. They knew, oh, wow, this is this. You know, what he said was true, and here it is. So now they both, Jude or Judah and James, are now pressing the gospel, spreading the word. The recipients, the letter is addressed to those who are called, without any specific designation as to who they were or where they lived. The references to Old Testament indicates incidents and extra-biblical resources that we just talked about strongly suggest that the original readers were Jewish Christians, perhaps living in Palestine. Time and place of the writing. Similarities between the Epistle of Jude and the Second Epistle of Peter indicate one author may have influenced the other. Since Peter wrote of false teachers who were to come, and Jude warned of those who were already crept in unnoticed, it's possible that Jude wrote after Peter. Peter's death during the reign of Nero, which ended in 68 AD, places his own epistle sometime between 67 AD, before 67 AD, I'm sorry. The lack of any mention of the destruction of Jerusalem, which occurred during the fall of 70 AD, suggests that Jude wrote before that notable event. If so, then the date of composition may have been between 67 and 70 AD. Purpose and theme of the epistle. Jude's original purpose in penning this epistle was to write of the common salvation he and his readers shared. But the presence of ungodly men and the danger of them leading Christians astray forced a change in purpose. One was to encourage his readers, to encourage his readers to contend earnestly for the faith that had been delivered to the saints. As for the theme, Jude's first admonition serves us well. Contend earnestly for the faith. So here's the outline of the book of Jude. Here's the simple outline of the book. We have the greetings, verses 1 through 2. The purpose of the writing, 3 through 4. God's judgment in time past, 5 through 7. Character and doom of false teachers, 8 through 19. Exhortations to build their faith, 20 to 23. And concluding doxology is 24 through 25. So objectives in studying this chapter. The faith revealed once for all, literally one time for all time. The character of false teachers, how to build up your most holy faith. Let's start out. Chapter 1, introduction, Jude 1, 2. Jude, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, the brother of James, to those who are called, sanctified by God and the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ. Mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. His greeting. We deal with one, the author. The letter is from Jude. Again, what I read first is from the New King James. Now you're getting it from the New Living Translation. This letter is from Jude, a slave of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. Now, Jude, bondservant of Jesus Christ, brother of James. The recipient says, I am writing to all who have been called by God the Father, who loves you and keeps you safe in the care of Jesus Christ. It's written to those who are called. We are. If you're a follower of Christ, you've been called. But we've been sanctified by God the Father. and preserved in Jesus Christ. Then his greetings, may God give you more and more mercy, peace, and love. Mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. So number two was Jude explains the purpose for the writing. Jude 3:4. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men, who turned the grace of our God into lewdness and denied the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. So this is how it reads in the New Living Translation, contend for the faith. Dear friends, I have been eagerly planning to write to you about the salvation we all share. Now I find that I must write about something else, urging you to defend the faith that God has entrusted once for all time to his holy people. I say this because some ungodly people have wormed their way into your church, saying that God's marvelous grace allows us to live immoral lives. The condemnation of such people was recorded long ago, for they have denied our only master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Man, this is so true even today. His writing concerning our common salvation, his pleading to contend for the faith delivered once for all to the saints. Acknowledgement of certain men who have crept in unnoticed and ungodly men who turn the grace of our God into lewdness and deny the Lord God and Jesus Christ. We're seeing this today where some of the churches that we grew up in, I guarantee you, if the church is still there and you go back to that church, it is not like it was when you grew up. The power of the Holy Spirit has been watered down. You don't have the fire anymore. You have more people trying to just, you know, fulfill their obligation to be there. And the word itself is not laced with fire and hope and strength, but more or less what you can do and how you can make your life better. And that's not how God expected us to do. So what has happened is, it's changed not from the people, but from leaders and those that's been sold amongst the congregation who've crept in unnoticed and sow seeds of division. Bible talks about the tares being brought up with the wheat. And I've got a sermon that I did, and I've got pictures of tares and wheat. And when you first look at them, both they look almost identical until it comes harvest time. Then you can tell the difference between the wheat and the tares. But as they're growing, as they're coming up together, they look virtually identical. And this is what has happened to our church. We've got people that have come in and have brought ungodly ways, and it's been very subtle, and they've come in unnoticed, that's caused the change in the way the church is today.
They call them new traditions.
New traditions.
They have new traditions.
Yeah. And oh yeah, almost definitely. You know, we can bring in, you know, the world and make the world more pleasurable than sacrifice and really going through something. I had a thought today. No cross, no crown. I'm gonna preach that one day. Yes. Oh yeah, that's the bar. It's a bar.
On Broad Street. Right?
On Broad Street.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a bar.
We have the best.
Oh, but I know.
We have the best.
Yeah. Yeah. But nobody cares that at one time was a house of God.
Oh, yeah.
And they've now made it just so common. Man, I wouldn't go in there if you paid. I'm sorry. I saw it. I'm like, oh, there is no way in the world I'd go in there. Even if I was in the street, I still wouldn't go in there. Because I know it used to be a church. Nah, man, you just don't do that. There it is. Number three, he reminds readers of God's judgment in the past. This is Jude 5-11. But I want to remind you, though you once knew this, that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. The angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day. As Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities around them in similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Likewise also, those dreamers defile the flesh, reject authority, and speak evil of dignitaries. Yet Michael the archangel, in contending with the devil, when he disputed over the body of Moses, dared not bring against him a reviling accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke you. This is part of that writing from the book of Enoch. But those speak evil of whatever they do not know. Whatever they know naturally, like brute beasts, in these things they correct themselves. Woe to them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, have run greedily in the errors of Balaam for profit, and perished in the rebellion of Korah. So this is new and old apostates. So I want to remind you, though you already know these things, that Jesus first rescued the nation of Israel from Egypt. But later he destroyed those who did not remain faithful. I remind you of the angels who did not stay within the limits of authority God gave them, but left the place where they belong. God has kept them securely chained in prisons of darkness, waiting for the great day of judgment. Don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah and their neighboring towns, which were filled with immorality and every kind of sexual perversion. Those cities were destroyed by fire and serve as a warning of the eternal fire of God's judgment. In the same way, these people who claim authority from their dreams live immoral lives, defy authority, and scoff at supernatural beings. But even Michael, one of the mightiest of the angels, did not dare accuse the devil of blasphemy, but simply said, "The Lord rebuke you." This took place when Michael was arguing with the devil about Moses' body. But these people scoff at things they do not understand. Like unthinking animals, they do whatever their instincts tell them, and so they bring about their own destruction. What sorrow awaits them? For they follow in the footsteps of Cain, who killed his brother. Like Balaam, they deceive people for money, and like Korah, they perish in their rebellion. So he gives a reminder of saving the believers from captivity in Egypt. A lot of times we have to be reminded that we have been delivered. You remember how you were before you met Christ. So a lot of times we have to be reminded, man he brought me out of that. He delivered me. I'm free now. And the destruction of the unbelievers. Because Korah did try to lead, because Moses, it seemed like he took so long to come down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments, that he's trying to lead people back to captivity. You know, he's got Aaron to mold and fashion a calf out of gold. And he's just starting rebellion. And the way it ended up was the earth, God opened up the earth, swallowed them all up in flame. Korah was right with him. Reminder of the fallen angels from heaven. A third of heaven was kicked out for being rebellious. And their future judgment, hell awaits. Reminder of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Burn up. Right now, due to sexual immorality and going after strange flesh, make of that what you will. I know what I'm thinking about, but make of that what you will. Dreamers that defile the flesh, reject authority, and speak evil of dignitaries. Michael the archangel, in contending with the devil, they speak evil of whatever they don't know, and everything they know, they corrupt themselves. Lastly, woe to them. They have gone in the way of Cain. Number four, what is the character? First of all, are there any questions over everything we've gone so far? Well, I'm going through this, but I say it's one chapter. And you really need to read this. And when I send this out to everyone, you will have that Bible project that you'll be able to see. Watch that again. And those scriptures that I had that I did not add, that's just reference, use those. Jude 12 through 19. These are spots in your love feast. While they feast with you without fear, serving only themselves. There are clouds without water, carried about by the wind. Late autumn trees without fruit, twice dead, pulled up by the roots. Raging waves of the sea, foaming up their own shame. Wandering stars, for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Now Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men, also saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000 of his saints. To execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have committed to an ungodly way, of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against them. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lust, and they mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken before by the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how they told you that there would be mockers in the last time who would walk according to their own ungodly lust. These are sensual persons who cause divisions, not having the Spirit. There are some movies coming out that are so against, they're making mockeries of the church. Yeah, Honk for Jesus. I saw the preview of that and I'm like, oh. How can you even, I mean, I know you want a paycheck, but man, my goodness, money in there. They don't believe. And that's just one of a few that are going to be coming out that are directly making fun of and mocking Christ and the church. And we wonder why people don't want to come. Wonder why it's hard to win. So because the enemy is trying to make such a mockery of the church and godly people. And people are just laughing it up and yuck, 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 and it's all so good. But they're sensual persons. They know how to play upon your senses. And they use that to pull you away. They're mocking. Paul talked about it. Peter talked about it. Here's Jude talking about it. He's telling you even Enoch wrote about it. Here we go. Apostates derived and doomed. This is just verses 12 through 15. When these people eat with you in your fellowship meals, commemorating the Lord's love, they are like dangerous reefs that can shipwreck you. They are like shameless shepherds who care only for themselves. They are like clouds blowing over the land without giving any rain. They are like trees in autumn that are doubly dead, for they bear no fruit and have been pulled up by the roots. They are like wild waves of the sea, churning up the foam of their shameful deeds. They are like wandering stars, doomed forever in blackest darkness. Enoch, who lived in the seventh generation after Adam, prophesied about these people. He said, listen, the Lord is coming with countless thousands of his holy ones to execute judgment on the people of the world. He will convict every person of all the ungodly things they have done and for all the insults that ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Wow. This is the seventh generation of Enoch talking about the coming of Christ. That's deep. They feast with you without fear, serving only themselves. They are clouds without water. Late autumn trees without fruit. Raging waves of the sea. Wandering stars from whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men. Okay? The Lord comes with 10,000 of his saints to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have committed in an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against them. It's coming. It's coming. We have certain powers to stop certain things. One of the things that we have the power to stop is with our purses and our wallets. We don't have to spend our money on those.
Which is why we have this.
Right. Exactly. We did. We got rid. Yeah, I'm not dealing with that. You're not getting my money. When all you do is you're promoting all this ungodly acts and actions. You know, we have the power for those who help to push this agenda out. Conglomerates, sponsors. Stop buying their stuff. Watch them start to change. As long as we keep fueling them, they're going to keep on doing it. And we don't know because we don't study. All we do is just, oh, well, it's all right. As long as it's not affecting me personally, it's all right. But it is affecting you personally. That's it. A B, apostates predicted, verses 16 through 19. These people are grumblers and complainers, living only to satisfy their desires. They brag loudly about themselves and they flatter others to get what they want. But you, my dear friends, must remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ predicted. They told you that in the last days there would be scoffers whose purpose in life is to satisfy their ungodly desires. These people are the ones who are creating divisions among you. They follow their natural instincts because they do not have God's spirit in them. Oh my goodness.
It's one thing to have self-help books because you know you have a problem with yourself.
Yes.
But some of the self-help books are really just, you know, it's like, how much of this do you need? And then how many self-help books do you need?
Well, I'll give you one example of something that has crept into the church that people don't think about, but they still do it and they allow it in the church, and that's yoga. People think, oh, yoga's fine. There's nothing wrong with yoga. Man, do you know what it means? Do you know the symbols? Do you know? Have you read about it? Oh, it's just exercise. Oh, really? Try pushbacks from the table, push-ups from the floor, walk, swim. A lot of exercises you can do. When you start getting into these poses and you start doing this breathing, you start doing this chanting and all, man, and we got it in our churches. Oh, but come to Christian yoga. Really? Huh?
No, I'm taking one step at a time, and I'm getting out personal. But most of the people here by comes from the goddess, the gods, and
beings. Yes.
That comes from that temple.
Yes.
The big sellers.
Yes. Yes. We don't think women don't think that's nothing about that. Oh, it's just, you know, they want to be unbelievable. Michelle, when you speak, you gotta speak up because somebody said they could hardly
hear. Okay.
A
lot of the human hair that they buy from the Koreans come from the temple in India that's dedicated to the gods in India.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you know. Most of the people that got all that, they half crazy anyway. You know, because I mean, it's not natural. It's not you. Now, I will say it, black women, you ain't got hair all the way down to your knees. You don't. You know, you wasn't born with that. It's either nappy or curly, but it ain't all the way down your back. You buying something, your nails. My mother used to drink Knox gelatin, which made her nails hard. That's why she had nice nails. But you'll go and you'll allow somebody to hold your hand and put something false on your hand. I've seen some eyelashes on some women so long. My goodness gracious, how can you even see? But we have standards that we utilize that the enemy has brought to us and has caused us to believe. Men, I'm telling you what, I've seen some pants so tight. Man, I know you greased up your behind to get in those jeans and in those pants. I mean, come on, man. You can't, and you gonna sit down? It's just, we have this idea of what beauty is and we
it's
don't.
False flattery.
It's all flattery. False flattery. And this is what's being, and it's not just in the world, it's creeping into the church. And we don't see it, but we allow it. And this is what is causing and creating divisions amongst us. These are, they're grumblers, they're complainers, they're walking according to their own lust, they mouth great swelling words, oh, it sounds so good. They're flattering people to gain advantage. But you, beloved, remember the words which were spoken by the apostles that talked about our Lord Jesus Christ. They told you that there will be mockers in the last times, and they are. They are out here just don't care, saying anything, doing anything in the name of the Lord. Who would walk according to their own ungodly lust, meaning to them it's fine. They want you to know that you got to accept me for me. Yeah, accept this of me. Right. What gender are you? Oh, there's 37 different genders. Really? Huh. I only know it too.
It's
stem on the apple or ain't. Bottom line, come on. Bottom line. You know, but people are making up things. They are walking according to their own ungodly lust. These are sensual persons who cause divisions and have not having the spirit. That's exactly what they are. And you're supposed to accept it. Really. 5, exhorting them to build up their most holy faith. This is June 20 through 23. But you, beloved, building yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And on some have compassion, making a distinction, but others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. In the New Living, it says, but you, dear friends, must build each other up in your most holy faith. Pray in the power of the Holy Spirit and await the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will bring you eternal life. In this way, you will keep yourself safe in God's love. You must show mercy to those whose faith is wavering. Yes, we must. Rescue others by snatching them from the flames of judgment. Show mercy to still others, but do so with great caution, hating the sins that contaminate their lives. Love the sinner, hate the sin. And they get that confused. They think because we don't accept homosexuality that we're haters. No, I love you. I love you dearly. God loves you. He don't like your sin. You can't get away from that. That's exactly what it is. I said it Sunday, I'll continue to say it. It's wrong. And God's word says so.
Period.
Bottom line. Build yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keeping yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. On some have compassion, making a distinction. Others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. So even when you have, we're supposed to have compassion, we're still supposed to have wisdom. Making a distinction for those who want the glories of God or who want to use the church for their own self-gratification. And I think Megan and you guys know this from the help you guys have given. Remember, we had a talk about this, about the people who, there are those who really want help, and then there's those that use your goodness just to, and their resources just to get over. Get stuff. They just want stuff. They don't want your word. They don't want your God. They just want your stuff. And it's telling us we still have to make a distinction. We still have to have compassion, but we still have to do it. What is the garment defiled by the flesh? The garment defiled by the flesh, in essence, is the sin of the person. How can I put this? A homosexual is a homosexual because of his sexual being. There have been many who have come from homosexuality and have changed because the sin of the act, what you do, what defiles your mind. These is the garments that's defiled by the flesh. It's there, but then you act upon it. You do it. That's why God can love the homosexual, but he hates the homosexual sin.
It's the same way with adultery right now.
Same way with adultery.
Yeah. Which you have now on Facebook.
Yeah.
I mean, you have all this pornography.
Yeah.
And that is adultery.
Yeah.
Because even sometimes you don't act on it. You've already
right.
committed to act
right.
in your mind. You,
exactly. So I hope that answers, hating even the garment that defiles the flesh or the act of what's going to defile
the
you.
The sin
that corrupts.
You do it.
We used to sing a song. Again, sometimes the verses skip me, But the choruses always stick with me. A part of the chorus of this one is yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. See, when you yield to it, when you do it, that is your defilement that's in your flesh. That is what is that. And so you need to strip off and get rid of that. That's the garment. You put it on.
Good example, Joseph running from Potiphar's wife.
There you go.
He ran out of his coat.
He ran out of his coat. So I hope that answers the question. That's a good question. Number six, he concludes with praise to God, Jude 24-25. Now to him who is able to keep us from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To God, our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power both now and forever. Amen. That's a great doxology. There are a lot of prayers that are ended like with this. I think it's wonderful. I love it. In the New Living says, now all glory to God who was able to keep you from falling away and will bring you with great joy into his glorious presence without a single fault. All glory to him who alone is God, our Savior through Jesus Christ our Lord. All glory, majesty, power, and authority are his before all time and in the present beyond all time. Amen. So to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, which he is, to present you faultless, which he can, before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, which you will have, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, yes, he is, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, which he has, both now and forever. Amen. Yeah, buddy. So review questions for the chapter. We'll just run through those. I was kind of worried if I was going to get through this, but I did. What are the main points of this chapter? They are the greetings, the purpose for the writings, God's judgment in times past, character and doom of false teachers, exhortations to build up your faith, and the concluding doxology. How does Jude describe the recipients of his epistle? They are called sanctified, and they're called, we're sanctified, and we're preserved. What did Jude find necessary to exhort his readers, and why? To contend earnestly for the faith delivered once for all to the saints. We have to constantly contend for, keep ourselves built up in the faith that we have, because it's been delivered. You only had to do it one time, but it's for all the saints, for whosoever believes shall not perish, but have everlasting life. He only had died once. Some were turning God's grace into lewdness, denying God and Jesus. That's why. How can you turn God's grace into lewdness? Yeah, but language. I like language. The sex, I mean, yeah. But there are many that deny God and they deny Jesus. We went, Michelle and I went and saw the play last night, C.S. Lewis, The Reluctant Convert. I'm telling you, it was riveting. It was inspiring. It was phenomenal to listen to this man's conversion from being an atheist.
Instead of trying to set out to
prove that he did not exist, to now becoming at the end, he's like, I believe he is God. He believed God before he believed about Jesus Christ. He believed there was God, but you couldn't tell him nothing about Jesus Christ till the conversion was complete.
Well, God set him up.
God set him up because all his friends were Christians.
And everybody he read
were Christians.
He didn't know that.
He didn't know that from first. And it was just, I mean, this play was so awesome last night. I got chills. It was just wonderful. But there are those that do deny God. They deny Christ. They do not believe in his existence. And he's real. List both biblical and extra-biblical examples given by Jude. One was the Israelites, when they were delivered, but yet some died because of unbelief. Angels who sinned, kicked out of heaven. Sodom and Gomorrah, burned. Cain killed his brother, banished. Balaam tried to curse and try to use what he knew for money. And then Korah, who in the end he thought he would take over, lead everybody back to Pharaoh, ended up dying, burned up too. Michael contending with the devil, Enoch and his prophecy. List the qualities of the false teachers. The qualities of the false teachers are condemned and defile the flesh, reject authority, speak evil of what they do not know, corrupt themselves in what they know naturally, serve only themselves, grumblers, complainers, sensual, devoid of the spirit. Number six, what counsel does Jude give to build oneself up in the faith? Remain in the love of God, pray in the Holy Spirit for mercy unto eternal life. I don't know what I did. All right, well, you got the gist of it. And with compassion and fear, try to save others. In his doxology, what does Jude say God is able to do? Keep us from stumbling, present us faultless before his glory with exceeding joy. That's it. That's the last.